Thine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed his fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Of 100 circling camps, they have built for him an altar in the evening dews and naps. I can read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His days marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Transfigures you and me. As he died to make men whole, let us live to make men free. While God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah.
Rescue the words that shall be spoken from these feeble lips of mine. I pray as our master teacher, you would come divinely near and bless us, tabernacle with us, use us for your glory and for your honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. We welcome you to this study hour as we continue to look in the sacred book, the Bible, and we continue to give guidance and instruction to God's children as we near the end of time. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, we have completed Revelation chapter 9, 1 through 9. We have been journeying, and God has been blessing, and I hope and trust the book is becoming much clearer for you. We are looking for Jesus in every text, and we are trying to see how he's working his purposes out, his divine providence and leading. And so we want you to see the big picture of the book. We also want you to understand what God is saying to the churches. And so I want you to journey with me now into Revelation chapter 10. 1 to 11 tonight. That shall be the focus of our study. We ended with the sixth trumpet in Revelation chapter 9. And just like how between the sixth and seventh seal, there was an interlude, so it is between the sixth and the seventh trumpet, there is an interlude. If you're reading your Bible, you will realize that the sixth trumpet brings you to Revelation chapter 9, that we have completed the entire chapter 9, but it did not, chapter 10 did not start with trumpet number 7. And you're like, where is trumpet number 7? You will not see trumpet number 7 until chapter 11. And I am going to delve into that interlude. So there is an interlude, just as how there was the interlude and the silence in heaven between those seals. So it is, there's an interlude in between the sixth and seventh trumpet. And so as we look at this tonight, we hope that you will be blessed. But everybody, take out the book, take out the sacred text. And we are going right now to Revelation chapter 10. Revelation chapter 10, and I will read with you, read in your hearing. Let us read together. It says here, and I saw still another mighty angel coming down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was on his head. His face was like the sun, and his feet like pillars of fire. Revelation chapter 10 and verse 2. He had a little book open in his hand, and he set his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land. And he cried with a loud voice as when a lion roars. When he cried out, seven thunders uttered their voices. Now, when the seven thunders uttered their voices, I was about to write. But I heard a voice from heaven saying to me, seal up the things which the seven thunders uttered and do not write them. Fascinating. Then the angel whom I saw standing on the sea and on the land raised up his hand to heaven and swore by him who lives forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that are in it, the earth and the things that are in it, and the sea and the things that are in it, that there should be delay no longer. But in the days of the sounding of the seventh angel, when he's about to sound, the mystery of God would be finished, as he declared to his servants, the prophets. Then the voice which I heard from heaven spoke to me again, saying, go, take the little book which is open in the hand of the angel who stands on the sea and on the earth. So I went to the angel and said to him, give me the little book. And he said to me, take and eat it, and it will make your stomach bitter, but it will be as sweet as honey in your mouth. Then I took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it. And it was as sweet as honey in my mouth. But when I had eaten it, my stomach became bitter. And he said to me, you must prophesy again about many peoples, nations, tongues, and kings. Revelation chapter 10, 1 through 10. Our subject tonight, ladies and gentlemen, the open little scroll, the little scroll. I entitled the study, The Little Scroll, The Little Scroll. If you are hearing me and it's clear to you, just type in the chat, the little scroll, Revelation 10, 1 through 11. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pause again to pray and seek your face. Oh God, we are not able to understand these things. Angels long to look into these things. And even now, my Lord, as I will seek to share in this study, may your words be as clear as day. Oh God, may your people have understanding in your words. May your hearts be pricked regarding the urgency of the hour in which we have come to live. Make your word plain tonight, and may we see Jesus high and lifted up is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Now, I want to begin this way. Revelation chapter 10, 1 through 11, ladies and gentlemen, is inserted between the sixth and seventh trumpets. Now, it's a sort of interlude, if you please, a sort of break between the sixth and seventh trumpet. Now, ladies and gentlemen, it is very fascinating that it is a similar pattern with the seals. Remember, when we studied the seals, there was a break between the sixth and seventh seal. And we have that silence in heaven and for half an hour and all of that good stuff. Now, ladies and gentlemen, when we looked in terms of the seven seals, an interlude really occurred between seal number six and seal number seven. And this interlude, if we recall, it really portrayed the sealing of God's people and the great redeemed multitude. Remember, we talked about that, standing before God's throne. The seventh trumpet in its series portrays a similar pattern. Remember, my method of teaching is repetition, expansion. Listen carefully as I go through, and for those of you who might be able to type in the chat, you can type the pointers as we go along. So point number one, ladies and gentlemen, Revelation chapter 10, 1 to 11, is inserted between the sixth and seventh trumpet. If you're typing, you can type that. Point number two, the same pattern that we saw between the sixth and seventh seals is similar between the sixth and seventh trumpets. The next point I want to make, ladies and gentlemen, is that there is the interlude between the sixth and seventh trumpet. You will be introduced, as you read in the text, that there was a strong angel. Can somebody say strong angel in the chat? There's strong angel. I need somebody to type as we're going through for the benefit of those who might be catching up. I need a typer or a typist. Between the sixth and seventh trumpet, ladies and gentlemen, there is an interlude. And this interlude, we see the picture, the imagery that I want to bring to your mind is that of a strong angel. And this strong angel, we see the strong angel with the open scroll. That's what we just read. Revelation chapter 10, 1 through 11. And then in Revelation chapter 11, 1 through 4, you will notice that there are two witnesses. So first imagery, a strong angel with an open scroll. Second imagery is two witnesses. Now, I want you to recognize something else that jumped out at me from the text that I want to bring to your attention in my introductory statements in this study. Do you remember that in Revelation chapter 7, when the question was asked in Revelation chapter 6, who shall be able to stand? And then the answer is given in Revelation chapter 7. Now, I have come to the realization, ladies and gentlemen, that just as how Revelation chapter 7 answers the question that was raised in the scene of the sixth seal in Revelation chapter 6 and verse 17, the interlude between the sixth and seventh trumpets, ladies and gentlemen, seems to provide the answer to a question. And the question is, what is the task of the church in these troublesome times? What should the church be doing in these troublesome times? Ladies and gentlemen, Revelation chapter 10, 1 through 11, describes the experience of the church, God's people, you and I, the pillar and the ground of truth, God's elect, you know, the called out ones, if you please. It describes the experience of God's people in the world and their role with reference, ladies and gentlemen, to the preaching of the gospel and the final days of Earth's history as it comes to a close. If you're following me, I want you to say amen in the chat. Amen in the chat. Go right ahead. Say amen if you're following me. So I've said a lot just now. I've said a lot for you to ruminate on. But you know my method: repetition, expansion. Let me repeat. Revelation chapter 10, so you can take your notes. Be like the Bereans. Revelation chapter 10 is inserted between the sixth and seventh trumpet. Now it is just as how we had the vision of the sixth and seventh seals. There was a break in the sixth and seventh seals. So there is a break, or what we call in the textual analysis, an interlude. There's an interlude between the sixth and seventh trumpets. I am also saying to you, our ladies and gentlemen, the trumpets and the seals, they seem to follow the same pattern. I want you to understand that the interlude between the sixth and seventh trumpet, we see as we read Revelation chapter 10, that there is a strong angel, and the strong angel, he has an open scroll. And the question, ladies and gentlemen, we see that imagery first in Revelation 10:1 through 11. Then we see the imagery in Revelation chapter 11:1-4 of the two witnesses. Now, I'm also positing to you, I'm presenting to you, I am submitting for your consideration as we study this text, that just as how Revelation chapter 7 answers the question of Revelation chapter 6, who is worthy to stand? And then John introduces us. He says, I saw upon Mount Zion 144,000, and he describes. And so John now answers the question that is raised in Revelation chapter 6. I am submitting to you for contemplation that there is a question, that there is a question. We saw as we have been going through the trumpets that these are troublesome times, that as we come down to the sixth trumpet, ladies and gentlemen, we see that there will be the gathering of the righteous and there is the gathering of the wicked. And the question that I believe is being posed right here as we close up the sixth trumpet, the question I believe is, what really, as we are coming through the end of time, what is the task of the church in these troublesome times? And I submit to you, ladies and gentlemen, that Revelation chapter 10 answers that question that sort of just resonated, or it came up or came out of our study of these trumpets. Because we see the trumpet, we see the degradation. Remember, I showed you the chart of the trumpets, ladies and gentlemen. We see what happened under the first trumpet. We see the fall of Jerusalem and all these things. We see the fall of Rome under the second trumpet from 300 to 476 AD. We also see the church defiled under the third trumpet from 313 to 53 AD. That's Revelation 8:9-11. We see under the fourth trumpet, papal dominion. Remember, we talked about that in depth when the papal persecuting power was at its zenith, if you please. 538 through 1798, the period of the Dark Ages. On the trumpet number 4, on the trumpet number 5, we saw the French Revolution. So it's degradation. It's a downward spiral. We come to the sixth trumpet. We see the gathering of the righteous and the gathering of the wicked. And we establish that this will go from 1844 until the close of probation. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we are right in between here, between the sixth and seventh trumpet, because under the seventh trumpet, it is the close of probation and what? The return of the Lord, the parousia, the second coming that we've all been looking for. And I'm submitting to you for consideration in the study tonight, ladies and gentlemen, that this interlude answers the question for the church. What should the church be doing during these troublesome times? Somebody type in the chat, troublesome times are here. Troublesome times are here. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to understand that based upon that premise that I've just established, Revelation chapter 10, 1 to chapter 11, verse 14, really describes the experience of God's people in the world and the role and responsibility that we have in reference to the preaching of the gospel in the final days of Earth's history. If you agree with me tonight that we are living in the final days of Earth's history, say final days in the chat, final days in the chat. Come on, I need 20 individuals to say final days, final days, final days. Come on, type, utilize the chat so I know that you're with me, final days. Ladies and gentlemen, we are in the final days of Earth's history, final days. I need 15 more individuals to type final days of Earth's history. Now, ladies and gentlemen, Revelation chapter 10, I am submitting to you tonight, Revelation chapter 10, it falls into two parts. I see there's a separation. It's two parts in Revelation chapter 10. When you read the text, and I'm going to read the text again for emphasis as we go through the text, Revelation 10, 1 through 11. And I'm going to tell you, then I'm going to read it so you can see. When you read the text, ladies and gentlemen, we see the portrayal of a strong angel with the open little scroll. And that's from Revelation chapter 10, 1 to 7. Now, after we see this strong angel with the little scroll, then it is followed by an angel's commission to John to prophesy again concerning the nations. Revelation chapter 10, 8 through 11. Listen now as I read the text. See if you're seeing the same things that I'm seeing so that we can agree on the word. Let's go again. Open your Bible to Revelation chapter 10, 1 through 11. The Bible says, I saw still another mighty angel coming down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was on his head. His face was like the sun, and his feet like the pillars of fire. He had a little book open in his hand, and he set his right foot on the sea, and his left foot on the land. And he cried with a loud voice, as when a lion roars. When he cried out, seven trumpets uttered their voices. Now, when the seven thunders uttered their voices, I was about to write, but I heard a voice from heaven saying to me, seal up the things which the seven trumpets uttered and do not write them. The angel whom I saw standing on the sea and on the land raised his hand to heaven and swore by him who lives forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that are in it, and the earth and the things that are in it, and the sea and the things that are in it, that there should be delay no longer. Your translation might say time no longer. But in the days of the sounding of the seventh angel, when he is about to sound, the mystery of God would be finished. as he declared to his servants, the prophets. Then the voice, listen now, the voice. So that's the first part of the text. Then the second part, then the voice, which I heard from heaven, spoke to me again, saying, go, take the little book, which is open in the hand of the angel who stands on the sea and on the earth. And so I went to the angel and said to him, give me the little book. And he said to me, take and eat it, and it will make your stomach bitter, but it will be as sweet as honey in your mouth. Then I took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it, and it was as sweet as honey in my mouth. But when I had eaten it, my stomach became bitter. And he said to me, you must prophesy again about many peoples, nations, tongues, and kings. Ladies and gentlemen, do you see the two parts to the text of Revelation chapter 10? If you see those two parts, ladies and gentlemen, just type amen in the chat. Part number one, we see here a strong angel with an open scroll. Revelation 10, 1 through 7. And then we see the angel commissioning John to prophesy again concerning the nations. Revelation 10, 8 through 11. If we're in agreement, I want you to say amen in the chat. Amen in the chat. Let me see if we're together. Amen. Beautiful. Now, we are going to take these in stages, all right? So dig with me now the first half of the text. So I've broken up the text in two parts. First half, little scroll, little scroll. First half, little scroll, ladies and gentlemen, little scroll. Now, I want you to dive with me into the little scroll. Now, the description of the sixth trumpet plague is completed. So we completed the sixth trumpet plague. We did that last week. Now the angels at the Euphrates River, remember? We talked about the angels at the Euphrates River, where the four winds are being held so that the sealing of God's people could take place. Revelation 7 verse 1, they are released. Revelation 9 verse 14, it's now time, ladies and gentlemen, for the great gathering of the battle of Armageddon. Now, I would imagine that you would expect to hear right here the sounding of the seventh trumpet. You know, as you're reading through the text, you're following the events and the flow, the ebb and flow of history, and you're saying, well, after all of this, then seven trumpets. But then there is this interlude. Now, instead of the sequence of the last two trumpets there is an interruption or an interlude, as I expressed earlier, between the last two trumpets. The reader, John, now shifts our attention to a scene that is quite different in character from the rest of the trumpets. And that is the text under consideration. Now, John says he sees a strong angel. So you're noting in your notebook, we're in verse 1. He says, I saw another mighty or strong angel. Now, Pastor, help me to understand a little bit more about this strong angel. Who is this strong angel? That is now introduced here. Now, I did a little word study. I looked at it, ladies and gentlemen. I did a little word study, and I wondered, is this Gabriel? Is this another angel? Is this Jesus? All of these questions have come up. Individuals have said various things regarding this. But the question is, who is this, this other strong angel? Now, the strong angel here, something it seems to correspond in my analysis of the text with the strong angel of Revelation 5 and verse 2. Remember that strong angel in Revelation 5 and verse 2, where it says in Revelation 5, let me just hop back over there and verse 2. He says, I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll written on the inside and on the back, sealed with seven seals. Then I saw a what? A strong angel. Is a similar a word that's used here, proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the scroll and to loose the seven seals. So it kind of, in my estimation, it seems to correspond with this text. It's a similar language, a similar expression, the strong angel. And so we see here clearly that in both texts, it refers to a strong angel or a mighty angel, right? And in the Greek, it is the word ischuros, ischuros. Ischuros, ladies and gentlemen, that are really associated with the heavenly scroll. So we see clearly that these strong angels, these mighty angels, ladies and gentlemen, they are associated with some heavenly scroll. They are associated with some heavenly mission or connection. Another thing that I observe, ladies and gentlemen, it appears clearly that the designation of the angel in Revelation 10 and verse 1, it says as another. You notice it says as another. It says another. If you look carefully, it says, I saw still another mighty angel. Now it denotes that he is not the angel that, or one of the angels, for that matter, one of the seven who blew the trumpet. So, ladies and gentlemen, a distinction is being made here. He's not one of those seven angels that blow the trumpet. He has a different mission. Follow me carefully, line upon line, precept upon precept. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let me walk with you through the pages of sacred scriptures. Go with me to the Old Testament, ladies and gentlemen. Now, in the Old Testament, there was an angel sent by God who, the angels, as you know, they function, they have authority, and they function with the authority of God. Angels, they come with authority, and they function with the authority of God. They are sent by God. They function in his capacity, in his authority. Now, let me read to you a text in Genesis. Hop over to Genesis 31, 11 through 13. So I want to emphasize, I'm going to journey with you through Old Testament. We're going to talk about the angels. We're going to talk about this another strong angel. And I'm going to propose to you who this strong angel might be. So I'm establishing here, if you're taking notes, I'm establishing here, ladies and gentlemen, when we look in the Old Testament, the angels sent by God always function in the authority of God. Genesis chapter 31, 11 through 13. Write that text down. So your point is, angels sent by God functions with the authority of God, and your text of reference is Genesis 31, 11 through 13. Listen to what the Bible says. Then the angel of God spoke to who? The angel of God spoke to me in a dream, saying, Jacob. And I said, here I am. And he said, lift up your eyes now and see all the rams which leap on the flocks are streaked, speckled and gray spotted, for I have seen all that Laban is doing to you. I have seen all that Laban is doing to you. I am the God of Bethel, where you anointed the pillar and where you made a vow to me. Now arise, get out of this land and return to the land of your family. So, ladies and gentlemen, we see clearly here that this angel is sent. This angel here, the angel of God. So the angel coming from God, the angel is sent, ladies and gentlemen, to speak with Jacob regarding his interaction with his uncle Laban, and we see the angel comes with authority and gives instruction. Now, I also want to take you over to Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 3. Walk with me in the pages of scripture. Exodus chapter 3, verse 2 through 6. We're going to encounter another angel. Now, in this case, and Moses, now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the back of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And watch this now, we are introduced to the angel. The angel of the Lord appeared to him in a what? In a flame of fire from the midst of a bush. So he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. Then Moses said, Exodus chapter 3, verse 2 through 6. Then Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moshe, Moshe, Moses. And he said, here am I, hineni. And he said, then he said, do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God, watch this now, of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face. He was afraid to look upon God. Ladies and gentlemen, we are in Revelation chapter 10. If you're just joining us, we're talking about the little scroll. We read through the text and we are proposing that Revelation chapter 10 is broken up into two parts. We submit to the class thus far that Revelation chapter 10 marks an interlude between the 6 and 7 trumpets of Revelation. And just as how there was an interlude between the 6 and 7 seals, we are now faced with the interlude between the 6 and 7 trumpets. Just as how Revelation chapter 6, when it ends in verse 17, the question is asked, who is able to stand? And the answer is given in Revelation chapter 7. We see the 144,000 standing upon Mount Zion, ladies and gentlemen. We also submit to the class that just as how there was an interlude and a question was asked at the end of Revelation chapter 6, I am proposing to the class tonight that there is an interlude between Revelation chapter 9, ladies and gentlemen, the 6th trumpet ending in the 9th chapter, so to speak, and the last few verses. And then there is an interlude which answers the question, what should God's people be doing in these troublesome times between the 6th and 7th trumpet? We are submitting and we're sharing with the class thus far that the text suggests to us that there was a strong angel. We are trying to identify who is that strong angel. I'm making the point that angels are sent from God with the authority of God. I'm also making the point, ladies and gentlemen, in Genesis chapter 31, 11 through 13, we also see here in Exodus chapter 3, verse 2 through 6, ladies and gentlemen, that Moses, as he was there at the backside of Midian, the angel of the Lord visited him. Now, I want you to also understand, ladies and gentlemen, that the description of this strong angel parallels in some way, shape, or form, or detail, in my estimation, ladies and gentlemen, I believe it parallels the detailed description of the glorified Christ in Revelation chapter 1, 13 through 15. Go with me to Revelation chapter 1, 13 through 15, ladies and gentlemen. Revelation chapter 1, 13 through 15. Let me read that for you. Listen carefully. The Bible says, and in the midst of the 7 lampstand, one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the feet and girded about the chest with a golden band. His head and his hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes like a flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass, as if refined in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. He had in his right hand 7 stars. Out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun shining in his strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. And he laid his hand on me, saying, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last." Ladies and gentlemen, students all, in this study tonight, I submit to you that the description of this strong angel, when you look at the textual references, when you look at the flow of the Greek, when you look at how this development takes place in terms of the book, it parallels in some detail, in my honest study of it, in some detail, ladies and gentlemen, in some detail, the exalted Christ in Revelation 1, 13 through 15, in Exodus chapter 3, 2 through 6, that's the Exodus text. Now, this description has led many individuals who have studied the text to say to themselves that this is Christ Jesus himself. Now, I have been looking carefully at the text. I've been looking carefully at the text, and there are a lot of things that pops out to me. There are many individuals who say it's Gabriel. There are many individuals who say it's Jesus, but I just want to suggest to you that there's a lot going on out there. Although the appearance of this angel is described in terms of deity, you see, it seems he is not Christ himself. This assertion that I am making tonight is based on the fact that Christ in Revelation is never referred to as an angel. Listen to me carefully, because I know there is a lot of varied opinions on this, but I stand on the line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little. In my study of Revelation, ladies and gentlemen, I have not seen where the Jesus Christ is really referred to, and clearly referred to as an angel. Never. I stand corrected. If you can find it, you can always reach out to me, ladies and gentlemen. It really, as you look at the text, it appears very clearly to you as if this is God. This is truly God. It's a deity, ladies and gentlemen. But I suggest to you that Jesus Christ is never referred to as an angel. So you may ask then, you may be asking yourself the question, so why should we view the strong angel as Christ and not the other strong angel in Revelation 5 verse 2? That's good. What seems very clear to me, ladies and gentlemen, as I study this book, what seems very clear to me as I study, ladies and gentlemen, is that an angel commissioned by Christ functions like Christ himself. An angel that's commissioned by Christ functions like Christ himself. For instance, go with me to Revelation 22. Revelation 22, I think I have my notes here, 6 through 16. Revelation 22, 6 through 16. It says here, "And he said to me, 'These words are faithful and true.' And the Lord God of the holy prophets sent his angel to show his servant the things which must shortly take place. 'Behold, I'm coming quickly. Blessed is he who keeps the words of the prophecy of this book.' Now I, John, saw and heard these things. And when I heard and saw, I fell down and worshiped before the feet of the angel," watch this now, "who showed me these things. Then he said to me, 'See that you do not do that, for I am your fellow servant.'" You would, as you're reading the text, it appears, and even in the text, you see there is, it's underscoring some scriptures, you will see red writing, red letter writing. So you say, oh, it's Jesus speaking here. So this angel is Jesus. And a lot of people, they really get tied up in crossed ears right there, ladies and gentlemen. But we have to follow the movement and the tenor of the text, because now John saw and heard these things. And when he heard, he was about to fall down to worship. And at the feet of the angel who showed him these things, then he said, "See that you do not do that, for I am your fellow servant and of your brethren, the prophets, and of those who keep the words of this book, worship God." And he said, "Do not seal the words of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand. He who is unjust, let him be unjust still. He who is filthy, let him be filthy still. He who is righteous, let him be righteous still. He who is holy, let him be holy still. And behold, I am coming quickly." You see, the angel is still speaking, but the angel is here speaking under the authority and with the authority of Christ. So, ladies and gentlemen, whenever we see this in the book of Revelation, ladies and gentlemen, it seems very clear that an angel that's commissioned by Christ functions like Christ himself. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you can see clearly in the rest of the text that this is so. For as we explain, the angel here is articulating clearly the words of Jesus. The angel is bearing clear messages, but the angel makes the clear distinction that I'm not Christ. Don't worship me, John. But as he speaks, he's bearing the message of Christ. I hope you're seeing that and you have come to grips with that. Now, the other thing, ladies and gentlemen, it is very reasonable, in my estimation, to assume that the Christ-like figure of Revelation chapter 10 is a special angel of exalted rank. It's very plausible, it's very possible. And this angel is functioning in the full representation and the full authority of Jesus Christ. Now, this is where I stand as I peruse the Greek and as I go line upon line, precept upon precept. I want you to understand that this strong angel, my brother, I don't know if it is Gabriel, but I know it's possible. It could be Gabriel. I know it's an angel of a high rank. And we know that Gabriel is an angel that's a high-ranking angel, but I am not going to submit that it is Gabriel. Neither I am suggesting that it is Jesus Christ, because I've showed you in scriptures that an angel who is commissioned by Christ functions like Christ. And so when this angel speaks, the angel speaks with the authority and almost the prerogative as his commission to function with the authority and representation of Christ. If that's clear, say amen. Now, great question. We know that Gabriel, yes, is the highest ranking angel, as far as we know, because when Lucifer fell, ladies and gentlemen, as we peruse scripture and the pen of inspiration, Lucifer was the light bearer. He was in that he walked up and down within the stones of fire. He was in the very presence of God. And we realize that he was an exalted angel. As a matter of fact, he had a great responsibility and he was given the name light bearer. And ladies and gentlemen, when he fell, I have seen in my own examination that Gabriel has a high authoritative responsibility and functions in great in the capacity as he's commissioned by Christ to carry out Christ's message. So I would concur that in terms of rank and file, if you please, and I think that there is order in heaven. We have the Council of Peace, which is God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the Council of Peace. And then we have these angels in terms of authority. Prior to Lucifer's fall, we had Lucifer, we had Gabriel, we had also seraphims and cherubims and, you know, different angelic orders, ladies and gentlemen, and heavenly hosts and all these things, ladies and gentlemen. So there is some sort of order if you look carefully at the host, the heavenly host, how things are structured. But suffice it to say, for this study tonight, I am proposing that this strong angel is an angel, an exalted angel, who is functioning in the full representation and the authority of Christ. Now, when we see this angel, the angel had a little scroll. Somebody type Little Scroll one more time in the chat, Little Scroll. Now, the word, if my Greek don't fail me, is the word here for little scroll is biblaridon. Biblaridon, ladies and gentlemen, is that Greek expression for little scroll. It really denotes in the Greek a small papyrus. You know, they did not have paper as we now have it. So these things were written on the papyrus, ladies and gentlemen, which were like the barks of the papyri plant tree. And so it denotes a small papyrus scroll, ladies, similar to that of Revelation chapter 5 and verse 1. And this is where we get the word biblion. Biblion is really, a derivative the Bibliaridon, which is, it really suggests a little scroll or a diminutive of Biblios. Thus we will see later in the text, ladies and gentlemen, it's the diminutive meaning of Biblion. It really vanishes by the time of John's words. John uses the word Bibliaridon. Now it was used to describe from the Greek here, a scroll of a smaller size. So Biblion and Biblios, really? They gradually came over time to have the same meaning. They were used synonymously several places, interchangeably in reference to the scroll, regardless of its size. Now, when you carefully analyze Biblios, Biblion, Bibliaradion in Revelation, it suggests something. It shows here, ladies and gentlemen, that John, the revelator, he does not really have a consistent pattern in the usage of these words. And I'm telling you this for a reason. I'm going somewhere. I'm just laying a foundation. Now, for instance, in Revelation chapter 20, John used Biblios and Biblia interchangeably for the book of life, right? Revelation chapter 20 and verse 12. It is the Biblion of life. In Revelation chapter 13 and verse 8. In Revelation chapter 17 and verse 8. In Revelation chapter 21 and verse 27. But in Revelation chapter 20 and verse 15, ladies and gentlemen, it is the Biblos of life. Now, it is very interesting that in Revelation 10 and verse 2, the little scroll is called Bibliaridon. And in verse 8 of the same text, it is called Biblion. Now, what are you aiming at, Pastor Haye? You're talking here about something. I'm going somewhere. Can I submit to you tonight, ladies and gentlemen, that this change suggests clearly that there is no consistent or purposeful use of one or the other form of the word for scroll? Now, the probable reason why John used this word in Revelation chapter 10 and the emphasis is on the fact that it was open is in an effort, watch this now, to contrast this scroll with the scroll of Revelation chapter 5. Which was large and closed and sealed. Now, a number, as I peruse carefully, ladies and gentlemen, I realize that there are a number of persuasive arguments and studies that have been done of the scroll of Revelation chapter 5 and the scroll of Revelation chapter 10 and they declare that they are identical. In fact, both scrolls are associated with a strong angel. I'm going somewhere. Stick with me. I'm taking my time. Both scrolls, they're associated with a strong angel. And it suggests that the two scrolls are closely related. So that's one. The other thing, the events of the breaking of the seven seals and the judgments of the seven trumpets, they are thus preliminary, preparing for the opening of the sealed scroll. Now, the disclosure of the contents of the seal must come after Revelation chapter 10. Now, the mention also, ladies and gentlemen, of the Ark of the Covenant at the close of the blowing of the trumpet in Revelation 11, 19, and the beginning of the vision starting in Revelation chapter 12 suggests that to be a disclosure of the real little scroll content. Now, the little scroll, ladies and gentlemen, of Revelation chapter 10 is suggesting, that's referred to here, ladies and gentlemen, it might be a portion of a larger scroll, okay? And it's a partial disclosure here of the divine revelation that God had sealed, and it is portrayed figuratively in the image of the seven sealed scroll of Revelation 5. Now, there is a very close link. There's a very close link between the two scrolls in the book of Revelation, as I expressed to you earlier. Now, one of the things I want you to realize, class, is that the contents of the sealed scroll in Revelation chapter 5 and will not be repeated here. You're going to notice it's not going to be that which is mentioned in Revelation 5 is repeated here. No, no, no. Revelation 4 through 10 is arranged, ladies and gentlemen, to follow the chain of transmission described in Revelation 1, 1 to 3, where Jesus receives the revelation from God. Jesus discloses the message to John through his angels. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, John is ordered to communicate these to the churches, the revelation disclosed to him as the word of prophecy. The contents of it are given in Revelation chapter 12, 22 to Revelation chapter 12 through 22 to chapter 22, ladies and gentlemen, verse 5. Now, there are many individuals who have argued about this, but I want to submit to you, ladies and gentlemen, something to consider this evening. Now, this scroll is delineated. This scroll, ladies and gentlemen, is clearly, this little book, this little scroll is clearly delineated in the language from all the other scrolls to express to the student and those who are reading, it's alluding to a scroll that was sealed up and would be opened. And so the expression bibliaridon, ladies and gentlemen, not biblios, not biblian, even though they are close, the derivatives, ladies and gentlemen, is used in here to clearly separate this scroll from all the others that are mentioned so far in the text. I'm suggesting to you, ladies and gentlemen, that the text in the scripture that shows us of a scroll that was sealed up and to be opened at the end is found in the Old Testament book of Daniel. Go with me to Daniel chapter 12, chapter 12. Go with me to Daniel, ladies and gentlemen, chapter 12. Follow me carefully. There is a distinction made. God did not want the scroll to be confused. In other words, I've gone through all of that to help you to understand that God did not want this little scroll to be confused with any other scroll. He wanted you to understand that there is a connection to this scroll and a previous one that was sealed up. Revelation, Daniel chapter 12. Daniel chapter 12. And we are at verse 9. Daniel here in Revelation chapter 12, and he said, He said, go your way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and are sealed till when? The time of the end. Somebody say time of the end in the chat. Time of the end. So the time of the end. Many shall be what? Purified, made white and refined. But the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand. And from the time that the daily sacrifice is taken away, and the abomination of desolation is set up, there shall be 1,290 days. Blessed is he who waits and comes to the 1,335 days. But you go your way till the end, for you shall rest and will arise to your inheritance at the end of the days. It says in verse 4, this is where I wanted to make my bed. It says verse 4. He says, but you, Daniel, shut up the words and what? Seal the book until the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. When you read the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Bible, the Old Testament, ladies and gentlemen, in Greek, you would realize, ladies and gentlemen, that the same word bibliaridon is found in that text, is also found in Revelation chapter 10. No coincidence, ladies and gentlemen. John, and God wanted his children to differentiate, to distinguish this little scroll from every other little scroll mentioned before. And so I submit to you upon a careful examination of the text, ladies and gentlemen, that this scroll, ladies and gentlemen, that is open, this little scroll, it is to the sealed, it refers to the sealed prophetic portion of Daniel with reference to the time of the end. It is disclosed to God's people in the end time. Revelation chapter 12 through chapter 22 will cover that period, ladies and gentlemen, with the purpose of helping them to prepare for the end time events that are to take place on earth. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the contents of the little scroll of Revelation chapter 10 is, in my honest estimation, not limited to only the prophetic portion of Daniel, because its content is broader. When you look at it carefully, yes, in the primary sense, it is referring to that scroll that was sealed and then is now open. So it's Daniel chapter 12, ladies and gentlemen, is now being opened. The sealed portion is being opened, ladies and gentlemen. And we see it clearly here that this is what is being opened. But in addition, it also includes the broader content of the book of Daniel. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let me show you something. The text says, and go back with me now to Revelation chapter 10. We're going back and forth to and fro in scriptures. I hope you're following me so far. So we see another mighty angel, right? And this mighty angel coming down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and he had a rainbow on his head. His face was like the sun, his feet like the feet. He had a little book. We saw that the little book, ladies and gentlemen, that is in his hand, is the sealed portion of the book of Daniel that is now being opened, ladies and gentlemen. And he set his foot, and it says open. He says he has a little book open. The little book is open. I don't want you to miss that word, open, in his hand. The little book is open in his hand. Now, open. What tense would that be? Open. Open, ladies and gentlemen, in the Greek, is what we call a perfect passive participle. That might not mean much to you, but let me break it down so you can understand in layman's term, because you're not going to miss it, ladies and gentlemen. Repetition and expansion, that's the approach I'm using. So open in the Greek is the perfect passive participle, if my memory serves me right, ladies and gentlemen. The perfect tense in Greek, it really indicates that the little scroll has been opened at some previous time. Okay? So we see here, ladies and gentlemen, the passive form functions here mostly like what we call a divine passing, which suggests that the opening of the scroll is a divine act of God. So watch this now, ladies and gentlemen. This scroll was opened. It indicates, ladies and gentlemen, that the scroll had been opened at some time previously. So this now is connecting to the book of Daniel. It's a direct link to the book of Daniel. And because it is functioning in this sense as a divine passive, it suggests to the careful study that the scroll, the opening of the scroll is not the act of man. The opening of the scroll is the act of God. It is God who is now opening this scroll. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the fact that the angel lifts up his right hand towards heaven in swearing the oath suggests that he holds the little scroll in his left hand. That would be clear for you because he raised, the text says, his right hand towards heaven, ladies and gentlemen. Now, watch this. When he raised his right hand towards heaven, ladies and gentlemen, verse 3 says, and he cried with a loud voice as when a lion roars, he cried out. When he cried out, the text says that seven thunders uttered their voices. Now, ladies and gentlemen, you're asking me now, Pastor, I understand you so far. I'm following you regarding this scroll. I understand what you're saying. You made it very clear. I understand what you said also, Pastor, about that angel, that strong angel. So we see the strong angel. We see that the strong angel has a book in his hand. We see, ladies and gentlemen, that the book is opened. We see clearly that this book is the sealed book of Daniel. But we now see in the text that when he cried with a loud voice, and when he cried out, seven thunders uttered their voice. What is the seven thunders that is in the text? I'm so glad you ask. That's why we are in this study, so you can understand what the word of God is saying. Now, the concept of the seven thunders, as mentioned here in Revelation chapter 10, is, in my careful analysis of the book, one of the most mysterious in all of the book of Revelation. The definite article in the Greek is used here. It says the seven thunders, not a or just seven thunders. It suggests, ladies and gentlemen, that the concept of the seven thunders was familiar to the Christians of John's day. When we go to the book of Psalms, go with me over there. Father, continue in your grace. Make plain the things of Scripture, the deep things of God, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. When we go to Psalm 29, ladies and gentlemen, is the key background text to the image of the seven thunders. Psalm 29, 3 through 9. I'm going to read a few verses of Psalm 29, 3 through 9 for you. Psalm 29, let me read 3 through 9. It says, the voice of the Lord is over the waters. The glory of God thunders. Underscore the word thunders in your Bible. The Lord is over many waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. Yes, the Lord splinters the cedars of Lebanon. He makes them also skip like a calf, Lebanon and Sirion, like the young wild ox. The voice of the Lord divides the flames of fire. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord makes the deer give birth and strips the forest bare, and in his temple, everyone says glory. Ladies and gentlemen, I see in this Old Testament passage, in the 29th division of the Psalm, an image of these thunders. Now, let me suggest to you a little bit more. Now, when you study Jewish tradition, you would realize they hold dearly that the voice of Yahweh on Sinai was heard as seven thunders. Listen to me carefully. When you study Jewish antiquity, when you study what their belief system, when you study their tradition, ladies and gentlemen, it is held in Jewish tradition that the voice of Yahweh upon Mount Sinai was heard as seven thunders. Now, ladies and gentlemen, when you carefully look at the Old Testament, when God speaks or he acts in power, it is often portrayed as the sound of thunder. You're getting it. You're getting it. Okay, let me give you biblical references because I'm not just speaking from the tip of my tongue. Go with me over there to my reference here just before Psalm Job chapter 26. And I'm at verse 14, Job 26 and verse 14. I am suggesting to you when God speaks and acts in power, it's often portrayed as the sound of thunder. That's your note for your notebook. Job 26 verse 14 is your text that we are looking at. Job chapter 26 and verse 14. It says, indeed, these are the mere edges of his ways. And how small a whisper we hear of him. But the thunder, do you see that word thunder? The thunder of his power, who can understand? Ladies and gentlemen, I'm submitting to you that when God speaks and he acts in power, it's often portrayed as a thunder. Let me give you more references. Job 37, let's go over to Job 37 and verse 5. Stick with me, I'm going somewhere. Job 37 and verse 5. When God speaks, it sounds like a thunder. When he speaks and he acts in power, it sounds like a thunder. It's portrayed as the sound of thunder. 37 and verse 5. God thunders, says Job, marvelously with his voice. He does great things which we cannot comprehend. So ladies and gentlemen, when God thunders, when God speaks, when he articulates, when he acts, ladies and gentlemen, it's the sound of thunder. Let's go to Psalm 18 and verse 3. Give you a little bit more context to this. Psalm 18 and verse 3. Psalm 18 and verse 3. If you're with us, say amen in the chat. Psalm 18 and verse, Psalm 18 and verse 13, rather. The Lord thundered from the heaven, and the Most High uttered his voice, hailstones and coals of fire. So, ladies and gentlemen, I am suggesting to you that when God speaks, when God acts in power, it's often portrayed as the sound of thunder. No, not only that, ladies and gentlemen, before the cross, in John chapter 12, when you have time, before the cross in John chapter 12, 28 and 29, let's go there. Let me go there. I'm not going to rush this thing. I'm taking my time so you can understand and this thing can sink deep within you. John chapter 12. John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John chapter 12, and I'm at verse 28 and 29. In John chapter 12, 28 and 29, the voice of God speaking in this text, ladies and gentlemen, the voice of God speaking in this text, speaking to Jesus, was perceived by those in the crowd as the sound of thunder. Look at this, John chapter 12, John chapter 12, 28 and 29. Listen carefully. It says here, therefore, you remember now, let's back up. Jesus says, my soul is troubled, 27, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour, but for this purpose I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven saying, I have both glorified it and will glorify it again. Therefore, this is not by accident, ladies and gentlemen. It's put there so that you and I tonight would understand this text in Revelation. Therefore, the people who stood by and heard it, what did they say? They said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to suggest to you that the voice of God speaking to Jesus was portrayed and perceived by those listening, the crowd, it sounded like thunder. Now, it's especially interesting that in this passage, ladies and gentlemen, we see it is followed by a reference to the judgment of the world and the expulsion of Satan. It is this same text. Saw Satan like lightning fall. It's very interesting that it speaks about thunder. It speaks also, if you look carefully at it, judgment of the world and the expulsion of Satan himself. That's John chapter 12, 30 and 31 highlights that. In the rest of the book of Revelation, as we look at it, in the rest of the book of Revelation, ladies and gentlemen, I've come to see thunder functions as the revelatory forewarning. I suggest to you tonight that thunders, as you look through the book of Revelation, the thunders, they function as a revelatory forewarning with regard to the divine activities in judgment. So these, when God is carrying out his divine activities, it is a reference to as thunders. Now, ladies and gentlemen, thunder really acts in this sense as the forewarning. We saw the thunder acting as the forewarning of the breaking of the seven seals. Remember when we were talking about the seven seals, Revelation 4 and verse 5 and 6 and verse 1, there was peals of thunder. When the plagues, the trumpet plagues in Revelation 8 verse 5, we have the thunder again. The warfare between the dragon and the woman leading to the seven last plague, Revelation 11 verse 90, thunder again. And to the conclusion of earth's history leading to the final judgment in Revelation 16 and verse 18, thunder. So thunder function as revelatory forewarning with regarding to the divine activities in judgment. God, it is now God's prerogative. God is about to judge. And so we hear this thunder. Now, I'm hastening on. So we see the angel. We see it's a strong angel. We see he has a book. We see, ladies and gentlemen, standing on the sea and the land. We see it's an open scroll. We understand it's referenced because of the Greek that's used, Bibliaridon. It's referenced into Daniel, the opening of the scroll of Daniel, ladies and gentlemen, the sealed book of Daniel, or the sealed portion of Daniel, ladies and gentlemen. We now are seeing, ladies and gentlemen, that there are seven thunders. These seven thunders suggest, ladies and gentlemen, that God is about to act. His divine act in judgment is about to be carried forward. And we are going to see the work of judgment and how this church, God's church, will be a judgment of our church. So all these imageries are wrapped up in the seven thunder. When you talk about this is the judgment of our church, this is the Laodicean church, this is the church at the end time, this is the church before the parousia, ladies and gentlemen, when you read that phrase, that expression, seven thunders, those images should come to your mind because they are referencing to the judgment of God here in this text. Now, the angel said something in verse 6, Revelation chapter 10 and verse 6, ladies and gentlemen. The angel says something. Go with me back to the text that we are studying tonight. If you're just joining us, we are looking at the little scroll of Revelation chapter 10. We are just breaking it down. What I'm doing is what they call an exegesis. I'm exegeting the text, ladies and gentlemen, so you can understand when you read, you understand. So when I am doing all the overarching themes and I'm drawing and pulling and milking the text so you can understand where we are at, you will be able to follow and you will be there. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the angel in verse 6 says, and he swore by him who lives forever, that time, who created heaven and the things that are in it, and the earth and the things that are in it, and the sea and the things that are in it, that there should be time no longer, or should it be delayed no longer. Time will be no longer. Time will be no longer. Ladies and gentlemen, this phrase, time no longer, is a literal translation of the Greek hote chronos uketaestai. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the Greek, and I'm saying this to you, to give, and this is a teaching moment I'm teaching, ladies and gentlemen. Now, the Greek language has two basic words for time. Chronos, where you get the word chronological, timing. And there is also, ladies and gentlemen, kairos, where it denotes a point of time, which is, it's translated as time. So there are two words, chronos, chronological, which is chronological, a period of time, broadly speaking, and kairos speaks to a more punctilious, a point of time fixed, or a definite period of time, a season. Now let me show you in the Bible where those words are used. Go with me to Matthew 11, verse 25. So when you hear the angel says, time no longer, you're going to understand what kind of time is the angel speaking about. Let's go to Matthew 11, I think. Say Matthew 11, and I am, help me, Holy Ghost. Matthew 11, verse... Matthew 11, verse 25 or 24, 25. Let me go. Matthew 11, verse 25. At that time, Jesus answered and said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have revealed these things from the wise and prudent and have reveal them to the babes. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to understand that's one reference. And at that time, you see the word time there. Time is used. A period, a season, ladies and gentlemen, a fixed period. Now let's go to 12 and verse 1. At that time, Jesus went through the grain fields on the Sabbath. And his disciples were hungry, and he began to pluck heads of grain and eat. This was at a specific time that Jesus went into the field. Now let's go over to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 3 and verse 19. We are going to see here 3 and verse 19. It says, repent therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, so that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. We see the use of the word again. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I want you also to look at Romans chapter 3 and verse 26. It says here, to you first, God having raised up his servant Jesus, sent him to bless you in turning away every one of you from your iniquities. That's Acts chapter 3. No, I'm reading Acts chapter 3. That should be Romans 3:26. Acts chapter 3 and verse 19. Acts 3 and verse 19. Yeah, repent therefore. But the text that I want to find that references this is, Romans. It's Romans chapter 3, not Acts chapter 3. It's Romans chapter 3 verse, thank you, Holy Spirit. Romans chapter 3 verse 26. Romans 3, verse 26. I just want to show you the usages, the various times that the word time is used and speaking to a definite period. We're talking, when you think of a definite period, you're thinking, ladies and gentlemen, of kairos, a point in time, a fixed time, a definite period or a season. Romans chapter 3, verse 26 says, to demonstrate at the present time, fixed time, definite season, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus Christ. Now, ladies and gentlemen, that's kairos. That's kairos. If that's clear, say amen in the chat. Kairos denotes fixed time. Like I say to you, I'm going to meet you at 10 a.m. That's kairos. Or this prayer line starts at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. That's kairos. It starts at 7 p.m. The time, 7 p.m. time, it is kairos. When it's a fixed time, that means it's not starting 7:02, it's not starting 7:03, it's starting 7 p.m. We saw that in the references. But when you think of the word chronos, The Greek word chronos, on the other hand, ladies and gentlemen, it implies a duration of time, a period, a space of time, like in Matthew chapter 25. Let's go to Matthew chapter 25 for a reference that shows you that the use of the word chronos. Matthew 25, and I think verse 19, it says, after a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with them. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a duration, a space of time. Now, although these two terms, ladies and gentlemen, often overlap, and they are synonyms, they are synonymous, if you please. Chronos and Kairos, in Acts chapter 1, verse 7, there is the same, they are synonymous. And in even 1 Thessalonians 5, 1 and 2, there about times and dates, they are used respectively, they are synonymous. Many individuals, as we study the text of Revelation chapter 10, this phrase, there will be time no longer, ladies and gentlemen, or no more delay. The translation has been contested by I read a very fascinating paper on this some time ago, ladies and gentlemen, where there are many individuals who argue that the delay is an inappropriate translation of chronos, because it assumes in this text that eschatological events have been postponed. Rather, ladies and gentlemen, the phrase means that the time will be up and the eschatological events will begin to unfold. Now, let me share with you a striking resemblance between Revelation. There's a striking resemblance between Revelation chapter 10, 1 to 7, and Daniel 12, 4 through 7. And this striking resemblance, ladies and gentlemen, suggests that the chronos of Revelation chapter 10, verse 1, should be understood in the light of Daniel chapter 12, 4 through 9. When you read the Septuagint, clearly, ladies and gentlemen, you could practically pick up the phraseology, the language from there, and drop it right in Revelation chapter 12, in Revelation chapter 10, and you would not miss a difference. And in Daniel chapter 12, ladies and gentlemen, it speaks about this time no longer, this time, the time of the end, this delay, ladies and gentlemen, this eschatological. Now, listen carefully. I'm going to read the text for you and listen carefully. But you, Daniel, close up and seal the words of the scroll until the time of the end. Right? Many will go here and there to increase knowledge. Then I, Daniel, looked, and there stood before me two others, one on in this bank of the river and one on the opposite bank. One of them said to the man clothed in linen who was above the waters of the river, how long will it be before the astonishing things, before these astonishing things are fulfilled? The man clothed in linen who was above the waters of the river lifted his right hand and his left hand toward heaven, and I heard him swear to him who lives forever, almost verbatim, similar to Daniel, to Revelation chapter 10, saying, to him that lives forever, it will be for a time and times and half a time. When the power of the holy people has been fully broken, all these things will be completed. I heard, but I did not understand. So I asked, my Lord, what will be the outcome of this? He replied, go your way, Daniel, because the words are closed up and sealed until the time of the end. So you see the similarities between the striking resemblance, ladies and gentlemen, Daniel chapter 12, 4 through 9, as we look at it. Now, there are several passages, parallel passages, that exist that suggest that Revelation chapter 10 follows up on Daniel chapter 12. First of all, let me parse this out for you. There is the command to seal up the words of the scroll until the end of time, Daniel 12, and that is similar is carried forward to Revelation 10, verse 4. You could parallel that. Next, there is a question that's asking Daniel, and also a question is asking Revelation, how long will it be before these astonishing things are fulfilled? Daniel asking in Daniel chapter 12, it is followed by a raising of the hands towards heaven, the swearing of an oath by one who lives forever, that it would be for a time and times and half the time, the time of the abomination of desolation, namely the Antichrist, the persecution of the saints. Now, Daniel was told that the end would certainly come when this prophesied time is completed. In Revelation chapter 6, for example, 9 through 11, the slain martyrs, remember, they were underneath the altar crying for deliverance and vindication. And their question was, how long, O Lord, before you vindicate us? They are told to wait for what? A short time, which is chronon, mikron, the same word chronos. In Revelation chapter 10, however, God's people are given the promise that there will be no more time or no more delay. The time is coming when at the sound of the trumpet of the seventh angel, the mystery of God will be completed as he proclaimed to his servants. Daniel in particular, ladies and gentlemen, this was proclaimed to Daniel. So what the text is saying, ladies and gentlemen, that which was proclaimed to Daniel is being fulfilled. God is about to fulfill. God is about to vindicate. God is about to deliver his faithful people. Now, I want you to understand that the servant of the Lord, Sister White, there is a statement that she made concerning the understanding of Revelation 10 and verse 6, which is in line. Many individuals said that she was no theologian, and I agree with them. But if you are to put her exposition and inspired commentary of the book of Revelation side by side, any excellent, well-interpreted, what we'd call study, or any real scholar in the 21st century who has properly exegeted Revelation, ladies and gentlemen, you would see that there is clearly a clear delineation and a clear understanding of the biblical text. Ladies and gentlemen, it's fascinating. When I read the book, The Great Controversy, and those of you who are reading the book with us, fascinating book, you can get the study guide and you can read along, just amazing, ladies and gentlemen. When you read that book and you line that book up with the book of Revelation, it is amazing. With precision, almost like a well-trained scholar, an exegete. She goes line upon line, precept upon precept. And in this text, she is correct regarding Revelation chapter 10 and verse 6. And I'm speaking to you from a scholarly perspective. I'm exegeting the text, and it lines up clearly from a careful analysis of the text with a reference that she makes. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, listen to this. Listen to this, my quotation. This time, I'm quoting her, this time referring to Revelation 10, verse 6, which the angel declares with a solemn oath, is not the end of world's history, neither of probationary time, but of prophetic time, which should precede the advent of the Lord, of our Lord. That is, the people will not have another message upon definite time. After this period of time, reaching from 1842 to 1844, there can be no definite tracing of the prophetic time. The longest reckoning reaches to the autumn of 1844 End quote. Ladies and gentlemen, in Daniel 8:14, unto 2,300 days, then shall the sanctuary be cleansed. Every wise-minded, spirit-led scholar in Christendom understand clearly that the 2,300 days of prophecy is not 2,300 days, but 2,300 years, starting from 457 to 1844, 2300. What the text is saying in Revelation 10 and verse 6, that at the end of this time, the end of the 2,300 days of Bible prophecy, there shall be no more time prophecy given to man until the end comes, ladies and gentlemen. So there can be no date setting. There can be no organizing and saying, this is going to happen this time. And ladies and gentlemen, no 2290, all these things that people are sending out charts and things. Listen to me, ladies and gentlemen, the last prophetic period ended in 1844, according to a biblical analysis and according to the mouth of the servant of God. Ladies and gentlemen, we are to be very careful. We are to be very careful not to follow those individuals who are setting dates. Ladies and gentlemen, we are not to set dates, ladies and gentlemen, regarding the coming of Christ. And the last time prophecy ended on October 22nd, 1844, when the angel raised his hand and says, time no longer. Ladies and gentlemen, it clearly delineates here, ladies and gentlemen, not the end of world's history, not the end of probation, but of prophetic time, which should precede the events of God. And that prophetic timing ended in 1844. The longest time prophecy came to an end at that time. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the angel also said in verse 7 that the mystery of God, Revelation 10 and verse 7, the mystery of God. When we think about the mystery of God, and this is where I'm going to pause tonight in this study, because I've given you a lot of meat to chew upon, a lot. It's heavy, I know. It's heavy, ladies and gentlemen, but that which we should have done in moments of ease and prosperity, we will have to now do it. These things we need to now learn, and we need to run. As we are learning them, we are running with the gospel, because time, ladies and gentlemen, time is coming to an end. I want you to understand that the angel says that the mystery of God. What is this mystery of God? Repetition. John sees in Revelation chapter 10, an angel, not just any kind of angel, ladies and gentlemen, a strong, mighty angel, a powerful angel, ladies and gentlemen. And this angel, the text says, as I head back there, this angel stands, ladies and gentlemen, he was clothed with a cloud, and there was a rainbow over his head, and his face was like the sun. This is a powerful angel, ladies and gentlemen, and his feet was like pillars of fire, and he had a little book, and we understand that little book to be the sealed portion of the book of the Daniel, the prophetic portion. And he set his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land, and he cried with a loud voice, when a lion roars, and when he cries, seven thunders. We understand the seven thunders referring to God's judgment, you know, ladies and gentlemen, uttered. And now when the seven thunders uttered, I was about to write, but I heard a voice from heaven saying to me, seal up the things which the seven thunders uttered and do not write them. The angel whom I saw standing on the sea and on the land raised his hand to heaven and swore by him who lives forever and ever, who created the heaven and the things that are on it, the earth and the things that are in it, and the sea and the things that are in it, that there shall be time no longer, delay no longer, but in the days of the sounding of the seventh angel, when he's about to sound, the mystery, mysterion, the mystery of God is finished, as he declared to his servants, the prophets. Now, ladies and gentlemen, what is this mystery of God? I'm so glad you asked. What is this mystery of God that is mentioned here in this text? Let me use the simplest language. You know I love simplicity. The mystery of God refers to God's purpose with reference to the future. All right, let me say that one more time. The mystery of God refers to God's purpose regarding with reference to the future. And this mystery is revealed through his specific chosen agents called the prophets. In Daniel chapter 2, God revealed mysteries to Nebuchadnezzar with reference to what will take place in the latter days, Daniel 2, 28 through 29, to bring Earth's history to an end and to establish his eternal kingdom. Daniel 2, verse 44, the stone cut out without hand. These mysteries, ladies and gentlemen, they were concealed from the wise men in Babylon. You can find that in Daniel chapter 2, verse 26, 27, thereabout, ladies and gentlemen. And God revealed his mysteries with reference to the future by means of prophets. He also stated through Amos. Amos 3, verse 7, he says what? Surely the Lord does nothing unless he what? He reveals his secret counsel to his servants, the prophets. That's Amos 3, verse 7. Now in the New Testament, ladies and gentlemen, the mystery of God. So number one, we established that the mystery of God refers to God's purpose with reference to the future. And he revealed this through his prophets as referenced in Daniel chapter 2. Now, when we come, ladies and gentlemen, to the New Testament, the mystery of God stands really for the whole purpose of God in the world. To establish, if you please, his eternal kingdom. So one way of seeing the mystery of God, ladies and gentlemen, is God's purpose with reference to the future. Another way, as we look in the New Testament, to see the mystery, ladies and gentlemen, is for the whole purpose of God to establish his eternal kingdom. Paul, the Apostle Paul, he explained that the mystery of God in Romans 16, 25 and 26, Paul says what? The mystery of God has been, quote, kept secret for long ages past, end quote, but has been made known through the preaching of the gospel. Romans 16, 25 and 26. Ladies and gentlemen, we also see Ephesians chapter 3, 4 through 12 is another reference, and Colossians chapter 1, 26 and 27. This mystery is revealed to God's people. Matthew chapter 13 and verse 11, you know, speaks about that. And Ephesians 1 verse 9. We have now come to the stewards of the mysteries of God. So we are the stewards of the mysteries of God, God's people. You know, things that have been kept mystery throughout the ages, they have been revealed, made known through the preaching of the gospel. And this mystery is revealed to God's people. And we are now seen as stewards of the mysteries of God, according to 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 1. So it remains a closed mystery to the unbelievers, however, to those who are outside the kingdom. You see that? Now, this mystery of God in the text, ladies and gentlemen, it symbolically portrayed in the image of the sealed scroll, right? And of Revelation 5. It discloses, its disclosure will take place at the sound of the trumpet of the seventh angel, when he is about to sound what it says, then the mystery of God will be completed as he proclaimed to his servants, the prophet. Now, this disclosure, ladies and gentlemen, of the mystery of God is described more in Revelation 20, 11 through 15. Let's go there. Revelation 20, 11 through 15. The Bible says, Revelation 20, 11 through 15. Then I saw a great white throne, and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them, and they were judged, each one according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. We see here, ladies and gentlemen, in the scene of the final opening of the book of destiny, at the eschatological judgment that will bring the history of this planet to its foreordained conclusion, we are seeing clearly here that the mystery of God shall be finished. Now, ladies and gentlemen, in summary, tonight as I close up this session, we are taking our time. Ladies and gentlemen, we are taking our time. And as we close tonight, I want you to understand, let me repeat and emphasize. John sees another angel. He is strong and is coming down from heaven. The magnificent appearance of this angel indicates he comes from the very presence of God. The angel is clothed with a cloud. Clouds in the Bible are associated with the appearance of God. In Revelation, the cloud is associated with the coming of Jesus. We saw that in Revelation 1, verse 7. The angel also has the rainbow over his head as the sign of God's covenant. Genesis 9, 12 through 17, which is a part of the glory of the throne of God. Ezekiel 1, 28. The rainbow is most likely created by the light of the angel's face shining through the cloud. The phrase, his face was like the sun, is a description of Jesus' face on the Mount of Transfiguration, Matthew 17 and verse 2. Feet like pillars of fire recall those of the glorified Christ, which were all like burnished bronze, as if refined in furnace. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 17. The angel's feet, like pillars of fire, are reminiscent of the pillar of fire that led Israel during the wilderness journey to the promised land. Exodus 14 and verse 19. Finally, the angel is as the roar of a lion, Revelation 10 and verse 3, which in the Bible is the voice of God, Jeremiah 25 and verse 30. I'm giving you a summary. This divine-like heavenly messenger is a legitimate representation of Christ. This divinely sent messenger is commissioned directly by him with a special message. The strong angel corresponds to the strong angel of Revelation 5, verse 2, who called for someone to open the scroll sealed with seven seals, and is evidently for the purpose to distinguish him from the seven trumpet angels, is the same as referenced in Revelation 8 and verse 3. In Revelation 5 and verse 2, he is seen in heaven, and now he's down on the earth, holding in his hand an open scroll. Several things we can note in this evening's study. First, the little scroll is sent by John as already open when the angel descends from heaven and appears to him. It was most likely opened in heaven before the angel was sent with the message to earth. Second, when we look at the emphasis that the scroll is seen open, it implies that it was previously closed and sealed and its contents kept hidden, which is paralleling the closed book or the closed scroll of Daniel chapter 12. Finally, the Greek suggests that the opening of the little scroll is a divine act of God. It is not the angel who opened the scroll, for the scroll was given to him by Christ after Christ had opened it. It appears, ladies and gentlemen, students all, that the little scroll of Daniel, of Revelation chapter 12, Revelation chapter 10, is related to the scroll of Daniel chapter 12. Ladies and gentlemen, God's open. It refers, the little suggests that it may contain a portion of the sealed scroll. We see clearly here, ladies and gentlemen, this little scroll is very important. We learn that its content has to do with the experience of God's people in the world in the last days. The experience of God's people is vivid language in the second half of Revelation from chapters 12 through 22. The disclosure of the contents of the scroll comes after Revelation chapter 12. Revelation chapter 10. Revelation chapter 12 through chapter 22, verse 5, thus proves to be a disclosure of the divine revelation, which has been only partially disclosed to John in symbol, and which he further conveyed to the church. We see that the final opening of the sealed scroll and the complete disclosure of the content belongs to the future period that brings history to its conclusion. And Daniel, that which was closed up to Daniel, was shut up or sealed up from Daniel, is now being revealed to God's children. The angel places his foot on the sea, his right foot on the sea, his left foot on the land. The land and the sea, ladies and gentlemen, taken together represents the whole of earth. It suggests here the universality and the worldwide dimension of the message that is proclaimed by this angel. It is especially interesting for us to note that in Revelation 13, it is out of the sea and out of the land that the beast comes, causing universal apostasy and rebellion against God. The angel cries with a loud voice that sounds like the roar of lions. In the Bible, I explained to you earlier that the voice of God speaking in the prophecy of impending judgment is like the roaring of a lion. We also see a special significance is the text from Amos. A lion has roared, who will fear? The Lord has spoken, who can but prophesy? Amos 3:8. In Revelation, when a strong angel announces a divine message, it is always done in a loud voice. This leads to the conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, that the strong angel of Revelation 10 is a representation of the voice of God with a special message for his people. The angel's roaring cry is immediately followed in the text by the sound of seven thunders. The sound of thunder, as I explained to you in the Bible, is a symbol of the voice of God manifested in mighty actions, warning of his activities and directed to his people who are dwelling on earth. The plurality of the thunders in Revelation chapter 10 as seven must be understood against the biblical concept of the number seven as a symbolic expression of divine fullness and totality. The seven thunders, whatever they are, seem to symbolize the fullness of the divine forewarning with reference to divine action about to take place before the time of the end. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, that's your summary for part one of the Little Scroll. Would you pray with me? Father in heaven, we see Jesus handing this scroll to that mighty angel. We see Jesus raising up a movement of destiny. We see Jesus in the text showing clearly to Adam's lost progeny that time will be no longer. Oh God, we pray that tonight's study would not have been an exercise in futility, but I pray that every word said, every passage read, would be imprinted and stamped upon the minds of your people. And like the Bereans, they will go back to study these things to see whether or not they are so. May every person who will listen and who will watch this recording realize that Jesus Christ is coming again. Realize that we are plunging, this world is plunging precipitously to a frightening tomorrow. But amidst the chaos and the mayhem of this age stands Jesus Christ, the righteous and only potentate of time, ready to receive his children, but first to journey with us through earth's darkest night, which is about to spread across this planet. Oh God, give us courage to stand and to be faithful, is my prayer in Jesus' mighty and powerful name. Amen and amen. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, you can't afford to miss part two of this most important study. It's getting sweeter as we go on.